This video SOP demonstrates how to set up the LabVIEW system. To set up LabVIEW, the operator will need to perform a series of tasks involving hardware, software, and networking configurations. This includes plugging in external devices such as pumps and scales via serial cables, and launching reactor-specific project files and IP routing table, among others. This SOP is designed to walk you through each action item. There are two computers that can operate LabVIEW, a primary and a backup system. This SOP will focus on the primary system. However, the walkthrough can essentially also be followed for the backup system. Note, this LabVIEW setup is utilized for C1, D1, and D2 ABEC systems. Each ABEC unit has its unique IP table and project file. Please choose according to the ABEC system you are using. In this SOP, the ABEC 300-liter bioreactor in the name D1 is used to demonstrate how LabVIEW is set up. Before setting up a LabVIEW system for each project, remember to restart the computer to clear any routing table and reset the computer memory. This is a critical step. Otherwise, the routing table might contain multiple IP addresses, which will confuse the LabVIEW system. In the desktop screen, right-click on d1iptable.bat. This IP address extension is a Windows script that establishes a connection between the ABEC PLC and LabVIEW via an Ethernet connection. Click Run as Administration. Then, in the pop-up window, click Yes. A command prompt will then pop up briefly and should disappear right away. Don't forget to plug in the Ethernet cable into the internal network switch. This is important for the routing connection to work. Once the connection is established, double-click on d1.lvproj to open Project Explorer. A vertical rectangular folder will then appear. In this Project Explorer folder, deploy all 5.lvlib files. These files are named D1 PLC tags, shared variables, local tags, sim tags, and blue vis tags. To deploy all 5 files at the same time, hold the control button on the keyboard and click each .lvlib file until all are highlighted. Then, let go of the control key. Right-click on the highlight and click Deploy All. A deployment progress window will then appear. Once the deployment progress is complete for all 5 files, the window will close automatically. In the Project Explorer, find Top Level Application folder and expand it by clicking the plus sign on its left. Double-click on the d1.vi file. A pop-up window will again appear to show compilation progress. Once complete, the front panel with the equipment's name written in the middle will show up. Now is a good time to change the cursor to operator value. To do this, locate the tools bar, which is usually in the lower right corner of the desktop screen. Then, click on the operator value cursor, which has a pointing finger icon. This step is to prevent any unintentional changes in the front panel layout. Under the configuration file in the front panel, click on the experimental title bar and change the name to your own experiment or project title. Under the configuration files in the front panel, click on the yellow folder icon next to the main config file bar. Main configuration have the feeding strategies files that can be used depending on your project's needs. From the file list, choose a .csv feeding strategy file and double-click on it. There are two main feeding strategies commonly used: continuous DO spike feeding and reloadable feeding. In the continuous DO spike feeding strategy, The culture can regulate the feed delivery based on the increase in dissolved oxygen and carbon depletion. This ensures that the feed is being supplied adequately, regardless of culture growth and feed consumption rates. Reloadable feeding strategy, on the other hand, is a flexible, time-based feeding strategy where feed is provided either continuously or semi-continuously. The three most commonly used reloadable feeding strategies are linear, exponential, and intermittent feeding. Next, in the front panel, under the configuration files, click on the archive file base name bar. The bar should have a project name written. Delete project name and replace it with your own project name. Your data will be saved under this project name. On the left-hand side of the front panel under subsystem parameters, click pumps. Each pump that can communicate with LabVIEW has a VESA resource name. Look for the name tag wrapped around the cable of the physical pump. Under the VESA resource name, click on the drop-down menu, which has a downward arrow. Select the name of the pump you are using. Now is also a good time to check that the pump itself is in auto mode. The pump is in auto mode if an exclamation mark is visible in the screen. If not, press the auto/manual button and select network. Putting the pump in auto mode allows LabVIEW to control it. Follow the same procedure for scales. On the VESA resource name drop-down menu, click on the scale name. Additionally, check the specific type of scale being used. Switch to O-House or Mettler according to what you are using. Next, activate the feed strategy. Still under the subsystem parameters, two feeding strategies can be selected, time 2 and spike death or detection. Time 2 is an open-loop reloadable time feed that follows the .csv feeding strategy file that you selected earlier. Spike detection is the most advanced, where the feed rate is relative on the DO change. In this SOP, time 2, a .csv-based reloadable feeding strategy is used for demonstration. Click the time 2 button. Notice that the screen is translucent. To activate the screen, click the pump cell box, delete the 0, retype it, and press enter. Additionally, check that the Bluetooth values are calibrated properly. Check that the hardware, such as the communication cables, are connected. The USB modbus must be blinking green. The license dongle is inserted. We can finally run the system. In the uppermost of the front panel, below the File, View, Edit, etc. bar, locate the arrow pointing to the right. This should be on the leftmost side of the bar. Wait for the deployment progress to finish. Once done, the arrow should visibly turn from white to black. Now that LabVIEW and ABEC PLC are connected, the data on both systems must be similar. Locate the Runtime button right below the equipment name. Runtime is between the setup and sysconfig, or system configuration. A list of system parameters should be visible in the left-hand side of the Runtime menu. Check that the numbers indicated for each parameter match those in the ABEC system itself. Also, the BlueO2 and CO2 parameters should be displaying numerical values in the runtime menu. Click on Pumps and check that the pump is responding. Uncheck the Pump button to hide the panel. Likewise, check the scale. The feed value showing up in the physical scale must correspond to the amount shown in LabVIEW. Uncheck the scale. The feed table specific for each project is loaded in the runtime panel. A reloadable feeding strategy is used here for demonstration. In the runtime screens, click Visibility to display a panel for feed name timetable-driven feed panel. Click on the feed table location folder and locate your file for the feed table. Note, the feed table must be in a .csv file, and the format should have the elapsed time in seconds on the first column and the pump percentage on the second column. Click Enable. Check the Channel Enable box. If needed, the multiplier can be changed to adjust the pump speed without changing the feed table directly. Check that the pump speed, elapsed time, total feed, and pump readback are showing up correctly. Check these values not only in the timetable-driven feed panel but also in the pump and scale windows. Check the pump and scale boxes again. Additionally, check that the physical pump is turning accordingly, and that the pump RPM is the same as in LabVIEW. Click on Visibility again to hide the timetable-driven feed panel. LabVIEW needs to be shut down once you've completed your project. To do so, click Global Stop, and then exit the software by clicking on the X button. Close the project and click on Don't Save All to prevent permanent changes on the system. It is also good practice to check if your files are being saved. This is also how you can access your files. To look for your project files, in the desktop screen, double-click on the projects folder and look for your own project name. The following guidelines can be used to troubleshoot the system.